Good evening. This is a great honor for me to introduce this this ceremony tonight, not only because I'm a marketing professor, and when we look at the career and companies that Paul Polman has been working for during many years for a marketing professor, obviously this is impressive. But it's also a great honor to have all of you tonight at ESCP Europe. I'm the Dean of Corporate Relations here, and I know that Paul Polman has never been in these premises before, but I also know that when he was working for Procter & Gamble in France, he has recruited many of our graduates, and actually many of them are here today, and this shows how happy they were to work with you. So this is in their name and in the name of our dean that I'm so happy to welcome you today. For a business school such as ESCP Europe that puts cultural diversity at the core of its values and daily practice, we have 5 campuses throughout Europe. Only half of our students are French. Your career is probably the best example that we can give to our students, since it's so international and since you have worked for the top 3 of FMCG companies in the world. So I guess this is why our audience tonight is so excited to hear your view on leadership. So we are happy to gather tonight, not only people who work and have been working for Procter & Gamble, Unilever, Danone, Colgate, and so many other companies, but we're also very happy to gather alumni for the top 3 business schools in France, ESCP Europe, HEC, and ESSEC, and all the people to whom you have left such amazing memories in the former companies you were part of. And it's not only about the past, but the present and the future, since I know many people here still work with you at Unilever and are so happy about it. We're also thrilled to welcome tonight Mr. Claude Meyer, Vice President of the Constellation Association, which organized this event, and former CEO Europe of Procter & Gamble. Because today, as you all know, our event is devoted to the wonderful project supported by Constellation. So, before leaving the floor to Claude Meyer, who will tell us more about the projects, the amazing projects that this association is supporting, I'm supposed not to forget to tell you to tweet, so please feel free to use this account, which has been creating for the special event of tonight, and enjoy this wonderful evening. Thank you.
Merci, Madame Manceau. Good evening. It is a real pleasure for me to introduce Paul Polman tonight and to thank him and Paul for coming here to Paris despite a grueling agenda. Let me also thank ESCP Europe for housing us in this very nice room. And I would like to thank particularly, I don't see him, Gilles Gouteux and Eva Mola Dujardin, don't see her, from ESCP for helping us organize this event. Paul and Kim have been friends for many years. In fact, Paul and I go back to 1983. I was then general manager of Procter & Gamble France, and Paul was a new associate within the finance department. And there is a tradition in P&G, that is, whenever the director comes see the general manager, he brings along his key executive, so the finance director would bring Paul with him. Now, let's call a cat a cat. This was not the easiest relation at the start. I was somewhat intrigued, surprised, by this young, tall, impetuous Dutchman who did not hesitate to contradict me. Then I realized the young, tall Dutchman was right most of the time and that he was making very good points with an excellent understanding of the business. So I became Paul's mentor. And within 2 years, I asked him whether he would agree to move to marketing as a prelude to a general management career. And as Paul remembers, within 2 years, 3 years, he was appointed general manager of Spain, and then he moved to the UK, our largest subsidiary. I was then president Europe Laundry and Cleaning Products, and so we continued our happy and sometimes spirited relationship, but certainly our friendship outside the business grew stronger. I do not find my words. Paul moved to the US, back to Europe, and then he left Procter to become Nestlé CFO in 2006. In 2008, he was sought out by Unilever to become their chief executive officer. Now, I think you'll easily believe that to have such an outstanding career, you need more qualities than the average cat. And so Paul does have all these qualities, and I'm not going, as is the case in most of these speeches, to talk about them, but I'm going to focus on just one, which is his very special ability to care and understand other people. And if you allow me, I will tell a personal private story which very well illustrates this. I have an autistic son, Christian. Now, for those of you who know autism, autistic people are scared by other people. They're scared to talk with them. They are not scared by their family, but they're scared by other people. So they do not mingle with others. They simply do not. Now, this is the wedding of one of our sons who is here tonight. And we go outside, pictures are taken, and Christian has disappeared. And suddenly, my wife and I see him talking with Paul. And Paul is talking with Christian. Extremely surprising. Paul's car and mine are next to each other, so we start walking to our cars. And then Christian, without even looking at me, goes straight into Paul's and Kim's car. Never done that before, never done that again. Amazing. I think this small story, if you follow it, really illustrates Paul's ability to care and understand other people. I think this is a very important quality for a chief executive officer to have, and certainly it makes working with Paul a lot of fun. Paul and Kim have a very big heart. They have supported for many, many years blind people in Africa, and they continue to do so despite a very heavy timetable. This is something I have in common with Paul. I help mentally handicapped people in Belgium to give them a roof, a place to live, we call that lieu de vie, and also help a third category, French people. And I would like to move a second to French pour vous parler d'une situation dont on ne parle jamais. Il y a à l'heure actuelle 6600 Français que j'appelle des exilés mentaux qui sont obligés de s'expatrier en Belgique par manque de place en France. Ça n'est pas un problème de droite ou de gauche puisque ça dure depuis 30 ans et ça ne fait qu'empirer. Ces gens au début venaient de Paris, aujourd'hui ils viennent de Marseille, de Toulouse, de Bordeaux, donc ils sont à des centaines de kilomètres de leur famille. Et puis ça fait 6600 jobs perdus pour la France, qui je crois en a besoin d'un certain nombre. Et ça fait 250 bâtiments, je me suis amusé à calculer, qui ne sont pas construits en France mais qui ont été construits en Belgique. Et au total, vous serez intéressé de savoir que la sécurité sociale française paye à la sécurité sociale belge 50% de plus pour prendre en charge les Français pour lesquels on ne veut pas, dont on ne veut pas s'occuper en France. Alors j'ai pensé vous en parler une seconde. On parle tout le temps des exilés fiscaux, grand sujet à la mode, mais on ne parle jamais des exilés mentaux. Et je voulais quand même vous en dire un mot. And to finish, I would like to thank all the companies who have been helping us. Their names are there. A big thank you. I also would like to thank all the individuals who have helped us. There simply would be too many names to put on the walls of this room, so we haven't done that. And finally, I would like to thank Unilever France for helping us organize this event, and particularly Sophie Jaillet, who's done a terrific job. And now it is my pleasure to introduce my friend and the Chief Executive Officer of Unilever, Paul Polman.
Bonjour à tous. C'est incroyable d'être ici. Moi, j'ai pensé de ça il y a longtemps quand Claude m'a appelé. Il a dit, est-ce que tu veux parler? Il s'est dit, je parle jamais. C'est rien à dire. Et quand il m'a dit le but pour faire cette discussion avec vous, c'est quand même quelque chose d'énorme. Et Claude, comme tout le monde le sait, c'est un homme avec un grand cœur. Muriel a encore un cœur un peu plus grand d'être marié avec Claude. Mais quand même. Moi, je suis assez touché avec tout le monde qui est ici parce que d'abord, je suis jamais allé à ESCP parce que je n'ai pas trop d'intelligence d'entrer dans cette grande école. So, au moins, je vais appeler ma mère ce soir et dire c'est à ESCP. J'ai aussi donné une présentation à Harvard une fois, donc je peux aussi dire que c'était à Harvard. Mais ça me fait plaisir de voir tout le monde ici. Mon unité de force de fente est ici, ils sont tous là. Ils sont où là? Levez-toi. Tous les vendeurs. C'est eux qui m'ont appris le français là, ils sont tous là. Comme on dit en français, on a monté la TG assez souvent. C'était ce matin dans un intermarché, ça m'a rappelé le bon temps qu'on a eu ensemble il y a maintenant 25 ans ou 30 ans, le temps profite. Mais aussi tous les autres qui sont ici, merci pour être venus parce que c'est le support que vous donnez à Claude et l'organisation, et ça c'est le plus important. On est ici pour quelque chose de plus grand que nous-mêmes, on est ici pour aider les autres et la meilleure chose qu'on peut faire pour recevoir. Pour recevoir la gratitude, c'est de donner quelque chose à d'autres personnes, surtout les personnes qui ne peuvent pas s'aider demain. Donc, merci à tous. Je vais continuer en anglais parce que sinon, il y a une ou deux personnes qui parlent l'anglais, c'est dommage. Ils sont où? Ils ont honte maintenant de dire ça. Anyway, let's go and become serious. First of all, I want to thank you for your generosity, honestly, because the total that Claude has raised is 150,000 euros, which is not a small amount, and this goes to an incredibly good cause. And it would not have been possible without all of you. And there are many children, you undoubtedly have seen the projects, and Claude has talked about it a little bit. But there are many that depend on that, and to be able to help these disabled children is enormous. Obviously, if you want to give more, it's always welcome. It's never too late. Donations can be made anywhere in Europe and the US. In fact, if you're in France and you're complaining a lot about the high tax rates, there's a big advantage if you have a high tax rate that the deductibility is more attractive. So if you want to give in France, that is certainly a big opportunity to do this. I know Claude has something outside or a table or people that can help you to get yourself through the process. ESCP also thanks for doing this. It's wonderful to make your room available or your space for all of us and to accommodate us. And I certainly look forward to discussing with all of you. I think what I really want to talk about is what Claude is doing right now, and that is really operating with a higher sense of purpose. I think that's what leadership really boils down to at the end of the day. There's not really one definition of leadership, and I'm certainly not the one to tell you what it is. But I always feel very simply someone who positively influences someone else. And you can only positively influence someone else if you live with a deeper purpose or a bigger purpose than just yourselves. And I think Claude is one of those people. The Jean Fernier, who is actually a Canadian humanitarian, and he actually just got the Templeman Prize, that's why I saw it. He's worked for about half a century already with people with disabilities, and it's a great man. And he actually says that that he has long argued that you become more of a full human being when you actually live side by side with some people that are different. And he says the relationship with disabled people is genuine because these people are they will never be in a position, nor do they act of being in a position of power or having hidden agendas. These people actually express what I think are the greatest qualities of leadership. So more than ever, I think in this world you need these type of people who rally on the unity that we have and the things that we have more in common versus dwelling on the many differences that sometimes papers and other people want to accentuate. But we have far more in common, obviously, than we have differences. It's also great to be back in Paris. We love Paris. Kim and I have obviously spent a lot of time in Paris, and two of our children are born here, so when we want to irritate them, we call them frogs. but they take it with honor. We really are a little bit Francophiles, having spent so much time here, and obviously we love being here. Today we had a great location in the office because our offices are in Rueil-Montmaison, and we just opened today the new offices, which actually is the greenest building now in France. Hopefully someone will beat us soon, because the more we get this competition on the race to the top, the better it will be for humanity, actually. But this is a building that actually gives energy, not only to the people, but it actually gives energy to the public system. So it's net positive contributor. There's no reason why you can't do that in many other buildings. Not surprisingly, we had Laurent Fabius, who's become a great friend, working together on the climate change negotiations here. That is a very important event I'll talk about in a minute. But he was kind enough to be with us and open it. So it's not only an investment in France and an investment in the building, but I think it's an investment in the future faith and belief that we have for this great country. And a great country it certainly is. A little over 9 months from now, a lot of people will have their eyes on France. And actually, a lot of them will have hopes for future generations, because once again, an important event will happen in France, which is what a lot of people call the COP21, which are the climate change agreements. We've worked to that a long time over the different years, and undoubtedly some of you have followed that. And this is an opportunity that we cannot miss. France has played many roles over the last few years in many important events, but if there is one that stands out, this UN climate change conference, it's probably the most important one, I believe, for human mankind. This actually will come a few months after in New York, in September, to be specific. The people that represent us from the 195 nations, more or less, that are in the UN, they will agree what the post-2015 development goals will be for this world. This world really has a challenge in terms of global governance, as many of you know. Don't have to talk too much about that. And more than ever do we need a framework of morality, of how we operate with each other, for the interest of the common good, just like Claude is doing with his project Constellations. So the thing that is being worked on is called the Sustainable Development Goals, and they follow something that is called the Millennium Development Goals. I could not think of a more important year for humanity to have these two events together. And obviously, the climate change negotiations that will be going on in Paris in December, built on these Sustainable Development Goals that I was just talking about in September. So it will be a year, if we behave rationally, if we set ourselves the ambitions, it will be a year, in my opinion, that will change the face of the world. And if we don't do that, it would be a shame. It would be difficult to explain to our children or their children. I think what's most exciting to me, actually, is that we will be the first generation, not the people before us, not the people after us. So actually, we will be the only generation that could say that at the same time, nobody else has to deal with the effects of climate change anymore, if we solve it, and nobody has to deal anymore with the effects of poverty, which is what these sustainable development goals are. Now, would that not be wonderful if we would be that generation that can say we were the ones that did it, versus we are the generation that messed it up? I know what side of the coin I want to be on. So it is a certain important event. In fact, Jeffrey Sachs, who some of you might know, said that Paris doesn't just represent our best chance, it actually represents our last chance, and I think he is absolutely right. Now, some of us remain skeptical, as you can see. I found this great cartoon that is there. I'll just read it for a second, because I thought that explained it all. Fortunately, the skeptics are becoming less, but anyway, we have to deal with those, and they just make us more determined. Now, I want to start on a positive note first. The world has made huge progress. We should be happy to live in this world. This is a wonderful world for all of us, irrespective of where we are or what we do. As we reflect on the importance and significance of 2015, this world has come far in recent years. The century may only be 15 years old, which is not much, but we've actually done an enormous amount. Globalization has delivered huge benefits. Some people feel threatened by it, but it has delivered huge benefits. It has opened many markets, has vastly increased the access to goods and services, trade between the different parts of the world. Capital flow that has gone freely has helped developed as well as developing nations get to higher levels of development. It's rising aspirations for many people, given opportunities. I would say I wouldn't be standing here were it not for globalization, and frankly, has lifted millions of people out of poverty. In fact, in the last three decades alone, about 500 million people are lifted out of poverty. The original Millennium Development Goals that were made in 2000 said we want to halve the number of people living in poverty. At that time, it was defined as $1.25 a day, and we've actually achieved that. So globalization has done enormous good for this world. It has also spread the ideas of democratic ideals, if you want to, and certainly established some standards of operating that I think will be beneficial for us in for a long time to come. It has created a global village to some extent. And with a global village, like any community, there obviously is also, like any global village, it looks after the needs of all of us. Nothing to be ashamed of, in my opinion. Now, the Millennium Development Goals, introduced at the turn of this century, have, as I said, resulted in reducing this poverty rate. But it has actually done much more. And it's also important to just remind ourselves of that. We've seen a massive reduction in mortality rates for maternal health. It was quite normal in many parts of the world that if you would have a baby, one out of two wouldn't make it past year one. And that has come down well beyond the goals that were set in 2000. So that's a good thing for women. Also more women in education now than any time in history. And that's a good thing as well. Diseases like malaria or tuberculosis have basically been eradicated. A little bit more to do, but enormous improvements. We've also seen this improvement in safe water. In fact, more people than ever have access to safe drinking water. And again, the goals that were set in 2000, which at that time were stretch goals, have been achieved. And last but not least, the number of children that died before the age of five have actually halved, a 50% reduction. And it could have been our children. So again, we should be very, very proud of that. People live healthier, longer lives in most parts of the world. Now that progress can only be achieved because at that time when we made these Millennium Development Goals in the year 2000, we sat together and we wrote these goals under shared and common beliefs and objectives. And a lot of people have rallied around these goals. At that time there were 8 goals, there will be a little bit more now, but because on that putting that interest ahead, or interest of others ahead of our own interest, we were able to achieve these wonderful results. There's no doubt in my mind that what was achieved over the last 15 years, we certainly have a chance, and certainly could, if we wanted to again once more, duplicate that in the coming 15 years. Obviously, technology has played an enormous role as well, and as you would expect, as technology comes more available, it again invents new technologies, and so it snowballs, and tremendous opportunities appear. The advance in science, in fact, in the last 5 years has been bigger than we've seen in the last 5,000 years, so that's enormous as well. In fact, the explosion over the last 15 years that we've all suffered from to some extent, which is the internet or the digital and revolution, as many call it, has empowered many individuals. Whilst we might live in a world where wealth is increasingly more concentrated, it certainly is the case that power or the ability to have a voice is incredibly dispersed. We soon will have 2/3 of the world population access to a mobile phone for sure, which will be the main device, or access to the internet is already by over half the population. And increasingly, consumers or citizens of this world are using that to make their voices be heard. The process of globalization, whatever country in the world you live in, is very difficult to see that that would be reversed at any time. That positive time that we're living in, actually, President Obama, for all his strengths and weaknesses, was talking about it at the UN last September when we were there. And he actually said, in his words, this is the best time in human history to be born. And I agree with you. For you are more likely to live longer than ever before. You're more likely to be more literate. you're more likely to be more healthy, and you're more likely actually to pursue the freedom of your dreams and to follow them. However, having said all these things, there are still too many challenges. And in any system where there are too many challenges, where too many people feel they're not participating or where they're excluded, it will ultimately rebel against itself. And that is what we're starting to see. So let me talk about that first for a second before we go into some of these solutions. So although Obama's words are fine words and I don't disagree with him, there's also another guy who is called Charles Dickens. And if you remember Charles Dickens, he wrote his book, The Tale of Two Cities, in the 1850s. And that book talked about two cities which are very appropriate for tonight. One is Paris and one is London. Undoubtedly, the situations in both cities have changed, and it is not today what it was then when he wrote it. But I think the way that he started his Tale of Two Cities is still as appropriate now as it was then. He said it was the best of times, it's the worst of times. And that is what we're facing. Globalization has left an unfortunate legacy. Although too many have benefited, as I said, too many have been left behind. They're still excluded. And as they are increasingly excluded in today's world, resentment and alienation, if you want to, is on the rise. Globalization has meant enormous disruptive shocks to some parts of the world, to some parts of the population, to some parts of, in fact, the people themselves that suffer from that, that frankly are not in charge of the way this world has to function. So it's often the poor, actually, that pay the price for this. The financial crisis and the economic slowdown in 2007-2008 was a good reminder, actually. Lots of people called it a financial crisis. I've actually often referred to this as a crisis of ethics or morality, where greed and self-interest took over from the interest in the public good. I think we started to discover with that crisis of 2007-2008 that although we had done all these wonderful things and lifted so many people out of poverty, it had come at an enormous price. Enormous price of public and private debt, overconsumption, and frankly leaving too many people behind. The world has become, as a result, a little bit more uncertain. It's come at the same time as global governance is increasingly failing. Now tension, therefore, is rapidly increasing. We move from one crisis in the world to the other. Talk about the Middle East. Kim and I were just there. We just came back from Egypt on Monday. And then we moved to the South China Sea, where everybody is fighting for a piece of land or a little island that all of a sudden is discovered thanks to Google Earth, I guess. And then we moved to the Russia-Ukraine crisis, and tomorrow we're waiting again for the next one. This is a total lack of global coherence at the political level to find solutions to some of these issues that make, I think, the process of what we're trying to solve, which is a better system for all, increasingly more difficult. And instead of having a process of convergence now, which we should be having, we're seeing actually stressed economies and very fragile politics, if you have my opinion. Some people have referred to this. It's a term that was coined by the U.S. War Academy in Carlisle, Pennsylvania. They've called it the FUCA world: volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. And that's probably the new normal that we will be living in. If someone says changes are faster than they've ever been, I would actually argue with you that changes today have never been so slow. What you see today actually is just the beginning of an oscillation. I remember the stock market, when it would move up or down 1.1 or 0.2 percentage points, you thought that your share price has moved a lot. Today, if it goes up and down like a yo-yo, 1 or 2 percentage points is no issue. Company valuations can go up by 5 or 10 billion in 1 week is no issue. Currencies can change by 20%, you know, in a day or two is no issue. So this volatility that we're now seeing in this interdependent world will only go up. Never has change been so slow, to be honest, and it will get increasingly faster. Now, we were in Davos in February. We had some wonderful meetings in Davos. And one of the things we always do is to ask all these CEOs that are there and all these other people, what are the things you're worried about? And interestingly, the biggest uncertainty was obviously the global economic growth, but most of them were actually answering that the geopolitical unrest, 71% of the CEOs, said that was the biggest issue, the geopolitical instability. There's not 1 month that you have to deal with a crisis in one way or another, and certainly in my case, if you run a global business. And the next biggest issue that they mentioned was actually social unrest. Stressed economics, fragile policies have made it more difficult and more urgent, actually, at the same time, to address the challenges that really concern the future of mankind and the future of this planet. Now, to make our challenges even bigger, the consumption patterns that I talked about are also unsustainable. WWF published a study about 1 or 2 years ago that we're already consuming the resources of 1.5 Earths. I don't know what you studied in school. I didn't study much of those days, but I do remember we have only one Mother Earth. In the US or Europe, if we continue to consume at the levels we are now, we need 3 to 5 Earths. We only have one. And frankly, all these people that are trying to come out of poverty, aspiring to live like us, the world cannot support that. It's severely resource strained, and obviously the approach that we have to our consumption, which is basically an approach that let's take, basically digging in the earth until I guess we get to Australia one day, but we take, we make, and we dispose. You take in my industry, where all the packaging in the world, only 10% of the packaging of all the products that we buy, that you buy, that I buy, only 10% is reused. 90% gets discarded in landfills. You've created an economic system of growth that is take, make, and dispose. And obviously we need to change our way of consumption. One of the things that is coming out is the circular economy. I can talk about that later, as a way to reuse all of our resources. And that's very well possible if we think about this. Because if we don't attack these issues, then increasingly we'll have to deal with the effects of climate change and other things. I know there are about 2% that are skeptics, but frankly 98% of the world has now finally realized that there is a real issue happening, and that we risk to, if we don't take drastic action, we risk to be above a 2% increase in the temperature. Most people actually think we're heading for a 4 to 6%. We can't support this wealth at a 4 to 6% increase. A 2% already, which we are currently doing, according to the IPCC, it's the one who makes all these studies, we have a 50% chance already today to exceed the 2%, is all the actions that we need to take. So 2014, once more, was the hottest year on record. We've had 15 years, 14 of them were the hottest years, and we continue to go. Not surprisingly, severe floods, severe droughts, islands are getting wiped out in the Pacifics, and off we go again, waiting for the next one to happen next week. In fact, the cost that we have to the global economy in the last 10 years alone on the extra disasters on top of the normal pattern has been over 2.7 trillion, and costs keep rapidly going up. Now you might say, fine, there were some very good things, there are some challenges, but are things getting worse or are things getting better? Obviously, there are many areas that things are getting better, and we should rejoice in that. But frankly, on the essence of things that we need to solve, they're actually getting worse. And that's why we need a wake-up call from all of us, and that's why leadership is needed more than ever. Let's look at some of them. Inequality. Inequality is getting worse. I hope you agree with that as well. There's something called the Gini coefficient that measures the level of the wealth discrepancy of the population between the rich and the poor. There's only one country in the world where it's actually going down. All the other countries in the world, it's going up. Oxfam just recently issued a study that we now, in 2016, will be in a situation where the richest 1% of the world population will have the same wealth as the bottom 50%. This system rewards capital. It doesn't reward labor anymore. Unemployment is going up, not surprisingly. And the ones that have the capital, most of us probably here, are getting the rewards. A good example of that is the recent quantitative easing again in Europe, when we've all decided in Europe now again to put in 1.1 trillion euros, we're not creating jobs. We see the stock markets going up to record highs. Now, interestingly, compared to 2007-2008, the crisis I talked about, which was a crisis of overextending debt, as I talked about, interestingly, the amount of debt has gone up. We have more debt now than we had in 2007-2008. In fact, if you look at government debt, the total level of government debt has gone up by another $25 trillion in this wealth. If you look at the total amount of debt, which includes our private debt and all the other things, we've actually gone up by $57 trillion. $57 trillion since we've had a crisis of debt. In fact, we're now at a staggering number of 286% of our GDP. What happened to this deleveraging we all talked about? Now, I don't know how you run your own households and how you spend your money, but if you run a deficit for too long at 280% of your GDP, which I assume is your income, I don't think your wife or your husband will be happy for too long. Now, consumption patterns are also getting worse. In fact, we were using 65 billion tons of raw materials in this wealth when we were living off 1.5 wells. That number has gone up, obviously. By 2020 and current projections, we're using 82 billion tons, nearly 50% more, of something that we don't have in the first place. At this rate of consumption, our finite resources are simply not sustainable. Now, climate change is also getting worse. In fact, as I said, 14 of the 15 warmest years have been in the last 15 years. The length and intensity of heat waves are increasing. In fact, interestingly, for the ones who went on holidays in Australia, they had to invent a new category of heat on their heat maps because they'd never seen these enormous temperatures before, even in a country like Australia. And people's sense of security and well-being, frankly, is not getting better either. We all worry about this. People feel they're not in charge anymore of all the things that happen around them, that the world has slipped away from them. They're not connected to politicians anymore. They frankly don't feel they're in control. Interestingly, tomorrow we have UN's Happiness Day. So make use of it. Not that it might be your last day, but perhaps we should start with that. I would also suggest you buy ice cream because it makes you smile. Or you might say, if you're we are the biggest ice cream sellers in the world, you might say, why are you fighting global warming? And you have a point. But we have a bigger picture here. It's interesting, Kim gave me an article yesterday when we came by train from London, and there was an article that came from a UK survey that was just published yesterday or the day before, and an organization called YouGov, which is very democratic, where everybody puts his opinion in. And they asked people, what's the quality you're looking for? What's the quality you're looking for in life? And very simply, these people said, we're looking for, obviously, security, we're looking for safety, we're looking for freedom, we're looking for compassion, we're looking for tolerance. Those were the most important things people were asking for. They weren't asking for more economic growth or salary increases. In fact, it came very low on the bottom line. If you today ask a Chinese, or I was in Delhi 2 weeks ago, by the way, with the distinction of the most polluted city in the world now, 15 of the 30 most polluted cities are in India now, and obviously many others in China. You ask people what they want. Sure, they want a better life. We all understand that. But the first thing they're asking is they want air they can breathe, for heaven's sake. They want security. They want the compassion. Not different from the UK as it is from Delhi or from anywhere in China. So we have to redefine a little bit the type of growth that we're under. And all these numbers that are getting worse is before another 2 to 3 billion will join the population. One thing is for sure, that we're going to 9, and some people think it might be even 10, 11 billion. Europe is the only region in the world that's going down. I still like Europe, but most of us collectively have clearly decided not to make love anymore. The rest of the world still does. So if you want to have fun, perhaps we should all move. But at the end of the day, we do need to accommodate these other 2 to 3 billion people, and that will put enormous pressure still further on these issues that we're talking about. So we need to address these issues. Now, to address these issues would be easy if everybody is in agreement. But in order to work together, first and foremost, you need trust. You cannot sit together and arrive at these solutions that are needed if trust is missing. And actually, the biggest erosion we've seen in any of this capital I talked about, economic or social capital, is in fact the erosion in trust. We've seen an enormous cynicism entering into politics in particular. In fact, the trust we have in politicians everywhere in the world is at an all-time low. There's no exception. Edelman, which is a PR company, issues every year that trust barometer. And the benefit of doing it every year is you can see if it goes up and down and it compares the different parts of society. And politicians are being seen as short-term and self-serving, and I think many of us could relate to that. In fact, in Europe alone, over half the people have no trust in their governments at all anymore and have totally disengaged of the political process. So you might say, We should blame politicians. I'm not in that camp, by the way, although it's easy to do. But you have to say, really, we need to help them more than ever. Unfortunately, the lack of trust also goes beyond politicians. The financial system, and as you might expect, which has operated too long under the principles, the benefits are mine, and if it doesn't turn out, the costs are for society. The financial industry has a very low level of trust as well. We still see manipulation of LIBOR rates, of foreign exchange rates. We see tax schemes that are totally asocial by any standards. And frankly, they haven't learned their lesson, in my opinion. Some are trying to be better than others, but frankly, they haven't learned their lessons. And we, as a result, see, it's by the way, one, it's the only industry in the history of mankind that has had fines of well over 100 billion. One of the banks, JP Morgan, had a fine of 13 billion, but was able to pay it out of their quarterly profits and still move forward again, just as writing off a little line on their balance sheet, on their income statement. But it's also true for other parts of businesses. People are getting fed up that they think they buy meat and they get, or they buy beef and they get horse meat. Or they think they buy a decently produced garment, and then all of a sudden they read in the papers that the factory it's produced in collapsed and 1,050 innocent women lost their lives. Whilst we talk about these 1,050 innocent women, and we think it's cool to buy a $1 t-shirt, they actually, in Bangladesh this was, if you remember, the Rana Plaza event, they got paid 11 cents an hour. 11 cents an hour. The next lowest country in the world is Vietnam at 26 cents an hour. Now, I don't know if you're in my camp or not, but 11 cents an hour to me is modern day slavery. But we think it's cool to buy a $1 t-shirt. It's not cool anymore. It's not cool anymore. So trust in business is low if they keep operating that way. We see safety issues in the Gulf with wealth exploding. We see issues with tainted food. It's nearly every day, and obviously with the transparency that you now have, an issue that happens in one part of the world is quickly known in other parts of the world. And CEOs, which obviously is a group of people you need to have pity for, I don't, but you need to, because their average length in office is only 4 years. In fact, when I told Kim it was only 4 years, he was very happy that I would be home soon, but this is my seventh year now and I'm not planning to give up, because one of the reasons that we're not addressing these issues is because we're so short in office. And you see the same in companies. In this environment now, where with that volatility, the average length of a publicly traded company is only 18 years. Trust in other institutions, by the way, is very low as well. In fact, many of the religious institutions don't score high either, Catholic Church being one of them. Although, coming to leadership, really the arrival of one person, in this case Pope Francis, has really made a difference. It's actually amazing how one person can change the sentiment and the mood and influence so many as a force for good. I'll come back to that later. But there is a change there, but trust in general in the institutions is low. One of the challenges we have is that when we decided to design global governance, which was really just at the time of Bretton Woods, if you remember, put yourself back in 45, 48, 80% of the world economy was basically in Europe and the US. So we designed a system with the IMF, with the World Bank, with the WTO, that is very much skewed towards Europe and the US. Obviously, the world has moved on. We now have China has a bigger economy than the US. 50% of our economy is already in emerging markets. And soon, 80% of the world population will live in these emerging markets. But our global governance has not reflected that yet. So that causes an incredible tension in trying to resolve some of these issues I've talked about. I think there are three big things that we need to address, and if we do, they're fine, and I'll talk about those. But before I do that, let me just say that in particular, as we look at these issues, where we need to change course, I'd first say we need to first of all regain a sense of purpose in all we do. We need to ask ourselves again what this is all about. Is this about me? Is this about my little circle, my well-being? Or is this about a bigger picture? What's the purpose of us being here? Bill George, who teaches in Harvard, wrote a book that is called True North. It's also very good in businesses. The more volatile it is, the more purpose you need of where you go. But we need to have a sense of purpose back. The second thing we need to do is redefine our approach to growth. What type of growth do we want? Don't we want the type of growth that is sustainable? Don't we want the type of growth that, yes, this many people out of poverty, but doesn't put more constraints or what people call planetary boundaries on the way we live. How can we grow and attack climate change at the same time? The circular economy I talked about is obviously one way of doing that. We also need to reevaluate the concept of capitalism. I don't think capitalism is bad, but I think capitalism needs to evolve and needs to evolve a little bit more rapidly than it has done. In the US, which you might call as one of the most capitalist countries in however's definition, when Franklin Roosevelt was there at that time, he made the New Deal. When he made the New Deal and introduced social security, healthcare, he developed a new type of capitalism that served society at that time fairly well. We need to evolve from what we have created in the 80s and 90s. And finally, obviously, we need to develop the leaders of tomorrow. Now, in addressing all these challenges that we have of purpose, of capitalism, of the way we grow, of developing leaders, we need to address really three things if you want to have it simple. And I think these three things really capture the areas we need to focus on. The first one is the battle of man versus nature. We think we dominate nature, but frankly, nature is more dominant than us. If we all decide to ruin nature, we actually ruin ourselves. Nature will be back in 100 years, 150 years later. But yet we think we can play with it. We think that we don't need to be in balance. In fact, Hubert Reeves had a wonderful quote, and I came across him, someone sent it to me a few weeks ago. But he said that man is the most insane species. He worships an invisible God and slaughters a visible nature, without realizing that this nature he slaughters is the invisible God he worships. It's exactly what we're doing. It's actually what scientists call the planetary boundaries. John Rockström, who runs in Stockholm the Resilience Institute, has defined 9 indicators, or markers if you want to, of the health of our planet. 3 of those, biodiversity, nitrogen levels, and yes, climate change, are already beyond what the scientists think are minimal acceptable levels. We are using our resources at a faster rate than we can replenish. Now, obviously, the governments have already agreed back in 2009, in fact, they already agreed in the 80s that we need to stay below the 2 degrees, but the actions that we're taking continue to project to 4 to 6%. So we need to be more decisive of how we move to a low carbon energy system. Now, the meaningful agreement for that reason in Paris is absolutely imperative. Because in this battle, there's only going to be one winner. And our one winner is nature, when we continue. The second battle that we need to win is the short versus the long term. Shouldn't be surprised to hear me say that. We are absolutely fixated on the short term, trying to find quick fixes. In fact, Roger Martin, who teaches at the Rossum School in Toronto, he wrote a book called Fixing the Game. It's about the short-termism in the financial market, satisfying that immediate appetite for return. How can you address the longer-term issues of food security, unemployment, climate change on a quarterly basis? There's a new book that came out last summer that talks about this, how this short-termism is getting actually worse in the financial market. It's a book called Flash Boys. I don't know if any of you have read it. It even talks about these guys putting the cables, making the cables a little shorter, one versus the other, so that they can trade quicker with whatever information they create themselves. The interest of short-term trading and short-term activities, literally milliseconds, is taking now dominance over the long-term shareholders. Even a company like Unilever now sees its total market cap being traded in 4 months' time. That's less than an annual report that we publish. Who are your shareholders? Should we cater to those people? Is the interest of those people the same as the interest that we have in making this a better world for all? Some questions to think about. Last week we were in New York and Larry Fink was there. He runs BlackRock, which is one of the biggest funds, obviously, of investment. He has more money under management than anybody else. And they're very worried, because if these big pension funds, which basically invest all of our money, if they can't invest properly in companies that are built to last versus built to sell or built to disappear, we actually put the risk of our own pensions at risk. And it's not surprising that he's asking for some changes in the capital markets and the way that functions, just like we are doing. Think about it. When I was in the US, I was surprised to see, in fact, that of all the CFOs in the US, they had this little survey, 57% of the CFOs would take the wrong decision. They would forego making a right long-term decision for their company if it would affect their quarterly profits. That's sick. Because they're making the wrong decision for the companies to just achieve these short-term targets. So we as corporate leaders need to do much more to create an environment to operate long-term. We need to be better in voicing our strategies. We need to be working with the regulators to do that. We need to be sure that the investor community understands these drivers of long-term value, that we can communicate, that we have other duties than just the shareholder duty. And yet very few CEOs are able to do this. Not surprisingly, because they're only there 4 years. But if you go to most of the laws in most of the countries, and you look at what are the fiduciary duties of boards, you will actually read that very few countries have as fiduciary duty of boards maximizing shareholder value. In many countries, including the US, the fiduciary duties are to a multiple of stakeholders. In fact, in Europe, most of the laws say that the role of the boards is to ensure the continuity of the companies as a first priority. Yet very few boards are behaving that way. Many companies in the US, or many states in the US, in fact, 26 states in the US, have now created what is called statute of B corporations, benefit corporations, where they actually have legal protection now to say that companies need to look at interest of multiple stakeholders, the communities, your employees, your value chain, your suppliers, and then, yes, also your shareholders. But if we don't get out of this shareholder primacy, we certainly wouldn't stop it. The principles of responsible investment that I'm on the board of what is called the UN Global Compact. We have about 12,000 companies that participate, and we've created the principles of responsible investment, which is about 30 trillion of investments under management. And they've all signed, about 1,000 investors, by the way, they've all signed these principles of investing for the longer term and trying to fight that. And it obviously is absolutely important. Now, these issues of short-termism, this fight between the long and short term, is not only in the financial market. You find it everywhere. You take the issue of food security, which is close to my heart. We have an inability to look at the longer term solutions. This is a world where about 1 billion people, to be exact, 860 million people, still go to bed every day hungry, not even knowing if they wake up the next day. And then, at the same time, we're able to waste 30 to 40% of the food as if it's nothing. And then on the other end, we're about to create the biggest epidemic the world has ever seen of diabetes 2 with obesity. And we're not able to solve that. In fact, the food we're wasting is about $700 to $800 billion of waste every year. The investments we need to make to have these 1 billion people not go to bed hungry is only $80 billion. Maybe one-tenth of it. And we can't figure it out. We call ourselves the most intelligent species. It's because we're myopically working on the short term. The third battle that we have is the battle I've alluded to before, which is few versus many. So man versus nature, short versus long term, and few versus many. I mentioned the study of Oxfam already. Ban Ki-moon, who is a great general secretary that we have at the UN, I really have a lot of admiration for him. He's leading the process on the post-2015 development goals. I had the honor to be at the high-level panel to help develop the recommendations of these goals, and now it's up to the member states, obviously, to find the final thing, the final agreements. But the goals that have been set is to use the next 15 years to irreversibly eradicate poverty in a more sustainable and equitable way. Not only sustainable for the reasons I talked about, but also more equitable way. It is simply not acceptable that we still have 1 out of 8 people, as I mentioned, go to bed hungry, that there are still 2 billion people not having access to clean water or sanitation. So there is a job to be done still. We have to finish the task, all these positive things, of what we've done over the previous 15 years, in the next 15 years. Now, people are rising up in despair, in my opinion. It started with this Occupy Wall Street movement. Unfortunately, they were not empowered to find solutions. and we didn't listen to them. But then we've seen people in the streets in Turkey. That wasn't because the trees were being cut down on the square. Then we saw people in the streets in Brazil. That wasn't because the bus fares were going up. We also saw people in a wonderful country that we just came from, of Egypt. In fact, talking about Egypt, this Arab Spring only took 17 days. Only took 17 days. They've always had high youth unemployment. They've always had corruption. They've always had volatile food prices. Yet Mubarak was there for 40 years in office, nearly. Why did it only take 17 days? Because we organize on Facebook, we communicate on Twitter, and we show the world what we do on YouTube. It's the first revolution, if you want to, that has been speeded up by the digitalization of society. And you'll see more of that, just like you saw last weekend again, a million people in the streets of Brazil. People are getting fed up. And the more you see this alienation and the less we're providing answers, the bigger the issue becomes. So how do we restore trust and how do we get on top of this? And how do we listen to these voices of these people that are wanting this change? Because once more, any system not in equilibrium will be rejected. Unilever, it's the only 2 minutes I'll talk about the wonderful company I represent, but we decided a few years ago to make a different business model, to decouple totally our growth from environmental impact. Unfortunately, may I say, no other company of our size or magnitude or scale has made that commitment. Yet it's absolutely needed. As a result of that, we've moved all of our factories already to zero waste. We are the leaders in moving to sustainable sourcing of our ingredients, about 60-70% of it now of all of our ingredients. In Europe, the US, we have green energy. And yet we are a viable concern. I know it cannot be done in 1 year, but if you give yourself a period of 10 years, you can do this. We made that commitment not only in our own shop, which is where most companies are. They call it CSR. I call it page 2 of the annual report. Look how good we are. You know, you need to take your responsibility on the total value chain. So we do. And we look at positively impacting, decoupling our growth, and positively impacting socially what we can across the whole value chain as well. Improve our social contributions, reduce our environmental contributions. It's not easy. We have to create the right environment as well. In fact, when I became the CEO in 2009, I abolished guidance. Very few companies have done that. There's no law that requires you to give guidance. But yet we're all in this race against this guidance and creating this foo-foo dust communication with the financial markets. We stopped doing our quarterly reporting. We introduced our Unilever Sustainable Living Plan, which I would argue is probably the most sustainable and equitable plan that has currently been invented. And it certainly is helping us drive our business growth. Our share price has done very well as a result of that, in my opinion. Just the last year alone, we're up 45%. We've more than doubled over the last 5 years. We haven't short-circuited anybody, including our shareholders. But we've brought this longer-term focus to the business, this longer-term focus that allows us to address these issues of substance that are needed to make this a better world for all. Now, we're going a little bit further. We said if we are a company where we operate in 190 countries, where we actually reach 2 billion consumers a day, more or less, we're in 7 or 8 out of 10 households in the world, how can you use the size and scale of an institution like that to have more transformative impact? And we're looking at 4 areas as far as we are concerned. One is water and sanitation, or water and hygiene, which is often called the WASH program. One is sustainable agriculture. One is enhancing livelihoods, creating more jobs, especially for women in the value chain. And the other one, not surprisingly, is to fight the issue of deforestation. Now you might say, why do you get involved in deforestation? Very simply, because half of the deforestation is because of the demand of food. We're a food company, so you have to take responsibility of your value chain. And now we're pushing what is called integrated reporting. If you don't count for the environmental or social impact, you will not act. We have created an accounting system, just like GDP of the country, that only measures the financial part. And a capitalist knows how to optimize the financial side if you define it as the financial side. But if we also define it as the environmental or social side, by going to a broader definition of reporting, a price on carbon would be a good example of that, then I think we're very well capable of attacking that. Now, the best thing that I believe is for consumer goods companies like ours is to actually use our brands as a force for good. Every brand should be a force for good. And obviously, we have many of them. Lifebuoy, which was a brand 6-7 years ago, that many people thought, why don't you stop selling it? Because we've sold it for 80 years, and the brand is old and stale. It's actually now one of our fastest growing brands. In fact, some of our forefathers who called it Lifebuoy thought about it. They called it Lifebuoy at that time in Victorian Britain in England because one out of two babies didn't make it either past year one because of the hygienic problems. That brand alone has now reached about 300 million children with hand washing campaigns. Just by the simple act of hand washing, you cut the mortality rate of children not reaching the age of 5 by 75%. By the way, I should have given you the simple statistic that this is still a world where 2 million children die every year under the age of 5 because of infectious diseases like pneumonia or diarrhea. Soap, pieces of bar soap, about the most accessible product that is in this world, can cut it by 75%. Look at how much time we spend, by the way, now that I'm on this topic, look at how much time we spend on trying to find this plane that has left, this Malaysian plane. Hundreds of millions of dollars already. Hundreds of millions of dollars. We still haven't found it. I hope we do. And obviously, it's a tragedy. But did you know that every day, 40 Boeing 747s crash to the earth with children who didn't make it past the age of 5? That's the 2 million we're talking about. And we're just sitting here not doing anything about it. We could attack that and solve that tomorrow if we wanted to. So if you have a brand and any other brand that provides that solution, that's great. Dove providing millions or hundreds of millions of women with self-esteem. The issue of women's self-esteem and having them fully participate in our economy is tremendous. Domestos bringing sanitation to millions of households. In fact, the goal I give to the brand is not grow it. I give them a number of toilets they need to build. I know that if they build enough toilets, they will grow. The objective is not growing. The objective is building toilets and you will grow. Just like the objective is of reaching children, teaching them hand washing, it's not just the numbers on the brand. The numbers will come if you do that well. Just like on our brand Knorr, it is to provide nutrition to everybody. Now, not surprisingly, if you have that business model, it's also motivating for everybody. That's why I'm there. We don't need to be there. We're all volunteers to some extent at our levels. Certainly, my management board is a volunteer. They don't need to work for us anymore. In fact, they don't need to work, none of them. But they work there because they want to make a difference. They want to leave this place a little bit better than they found it. It's not surprising that we are globally now the third most looked up company on LinkedIn, after Google and Apple. Totally unexplainable because we're not a brand. Unilever is not a brand. But certainly young people want to work there. 1.8 million apply every year. And in most countries that we operate, we are now by far the preferred employer. So there's something there that says people are looking for the right thing and want to be part of the right thing. So what is the role of business and the importance of partnerships that we have into this? It is very clear that we as a company or as individuals can do certain things, but we can't do it all. And that's why partnership comes in, and that's why we need to move to the next level. We need to define the partnership a little bit differently. We need to have courage to work together in a different form of partnership. Now, companies themselves are making quite some statements that things need to change. I just give you an example. 75% of the top 1,000 companies have now environmental and social goals. That wasn't the case 5 or 10 years ago. That's a good thing. In fact, when we started with this September climate summit we had last year, we worked with Jim Kim in the World Bank to create a statement on climate, on carbon pricing. We got 1,000 CEOs to sign that. That wouldn't have been the case 5 or 10 years ago. In fact, we got a total of 52% of the global economy to sign that. So people do want change. We work together with the World Business Council of Sustainable Development, the UN Global Compact, to move the world to more integrated reporting and to start measuring other things. We've created initiatives like Blueprint for Better Business to help other businesses find a true purpose, other than just satisfying shareholder needs. And obviously, we're trying to redefine the way capitalism should work in financial markets by rallying the responsible parts of the financial industry and see if we can provide different incentives for the investors, different transparencies for the financial community in itself. So things are moving, but they're simply not moving fast enough for what we need. And that is really why we need to step up the pace. And the only way that we can step up the pace, obviously, is with leadership. One of the things we've done with that leadership is to bring industries together, which is a very effective way of doing things, is to bring a few people together that can have a big impact and create tipping points. I firmly believe in something that is called a rule of 30. Often we try to get 150 countries or 190 countries or others in the room to find a common agreement, and that's very difficult. But if you bring the key right people together on something, you can get a tipping point. You take deforestation. You bring together the biggest traders in palm oil, Wilmar, Cargill, ADM, and you bring together the biggest users of palm oil, which is the consumer goods industry. You bring together a few countries where palm oil is produced, Indonesia, Malaysia, and you bring together some of the biggest financial institutions in the world, the World Bank or the government of the US, the UK, Norway, by the way, a lot of money. You can actually create a tipping point, and that's exactly what we're doing. We are moving out of that what I call illegal deforestation, which, by the way, is about 17% of global warming. So you can create these tipping points. It was Gandhi, actually, who said, of what we do to the forest of this world is but a mirror reflection of what we are doing to ourselves and to one another. And he's right. So we have to solve these things, and these partnerships are increasingly being formed to move it forward. But the biggest partnership we need to have is the partnership with ourselves, is the leadership, the who we are, and what makes us work. Because at the end of the day, things change in the world because of individuals. I've often said we are short of leaders and trees. Forget all the things I've talked about, were it not for my hope that I have in individuals to change this world. Just like Martin Luther King. In fact, we were just celebrating the 50th anniversary on his march to Selma, Alabama. I think Obama went there as well, which actually was the first time to register black voters, only 50 years ago. The act of a single man, just like it was Rosa Parks who changed the face of racial segregation in the US by simply refusing to stand up when she was sitting in the bus. Or, for example, Rachel Carson, who put the face of environmentalism on there when she pointed out the effects of DDT at that time or some of these dangerous chemicals, or many of the others that I can quote. But at the end of the day, it were individuals that are changing the face of this world. So that is what we need. When it comes to issues like slavery, when it comes to issues like same-sex marriage, and when it comes to issues like global warming, and when it comes to issues like equal rights or racial integration I talked about, we need the leaders to step up. Now, all of those brave men and women that we have in history went through some phases, all of them. Obviously, anytime you attack some of these big challenges, you'll first be ridiculed. Then you'll have people that will have violent opposition because it doesn't suit them. But eventually, you'll get acceptance. And I think on many of the issues I talked about, we are close to that acceptance, and we should now really push through. Don't shrink in the face of this opposition. If it was that easy to attack these issues, many people would have done it already before us. The skeptics that you meet along the way should only give you more resilience to stop it, to solve it. The cynics, frankly, I have no time for it. The cynics is the lowest form of taking responsibility. Those are people that totally abdicate their responsibility, and they should be simply neglected. But the skeptics should give you courage and resilience to solve this. We will solve it in New York in September when we do these sustainable development goals, and again in December here in Paris when we talk the climate change things. In New York, we can eradicate the poverty, we can promote sustainable consumption, we can protect the national resources, and at the same time we can have the sustainable development that we're looking for. And in Paris, we can keep our planetary boundaries within the 2 degrees. It was actually Ban Ki-moon who made it very clear that these social development agenda that we're talking in New York with the sustainable development goals is in fact the same as the climate change agenda. Climate change affects the poor. If we don't solve climate change, we are resilient enough in this part of the world. It's the poor that suffer. I'll just give you one example. When Hurricane Sandy hit the east coast of the United States just a year and a half ago, I have two sons in New York. They were having great time, anecdotes. They had to climb 50 stairs. They got a little bit fitter. They couldn't watch television. But in a few days, they were fine again, and they had a great time. But places like Haiti, they were pulled back another year or two on trying to climb out of poverty. So it's the poor that suffer. So anyway, to make it long or short, if we think we are powerless, it is absolutely not the case. The systems might sometimes look overwhelming, but there are many examples where people themselves are making the difference. And that is why I want to come back and end on the issue of leadership. First, I'm actually optimistic that we have the leaders in this world, and I'm optimistic actually that we can find solutions. I don't think we're powerless in light of these enormous challenges that we have ahead of ourselves, and that's why I'm certainly fighting for it, and I hope you as well. First, I think the arguments are being worn. We see far more facts now, also thanks to the digitization, that show increasingly so that the cost of inaction is rapidly becoming higher than the cost of action. So even if you don't believe in a deeper purpose or working for the common good, if you're a diehard capitalist and only look at the narrowly defined balance sheet and income statement, you will soon find that it is better to invest and avoid the issue than to deal with the issue. The cost of inaction is going to be higher than the cost of action. The second thing I'm very enthusiastic about is that technology is rapidly developing. We have 40 countries or regions in the world now where green energy is cheaper than carbon-based energy, despite the lower price today of carbon, and rapidly changing. Just like our office here has 4,000 square meters of solar panels on the roof and actually is a net contributor to the grid. Technology is developing very fast and finding solutions. And the third reason I'm an optimist is actually the young, the millennials. They call them the set generation, if you want to, or the millennial generation. These young people understand that. They understand that the next 15 years is going to be defining for them. And you might live here, but interestingly, and where 80% of the wealth is going to live, which is outside of Europe and the US, 50% of that population is below 25 years old. And they know very well that although they are 50% today, they're 100% tomorrow. And the next 15 years is going to be crucial for them. I've never seen such an enthusiasm of the young people to enroll in these issues, but we don't not too often give them the spaces at the table that they frankly deserve. So networks like One Young World or Global Shapers or the We Days or Free the Children or many of the other global networks of young people, we need to encourage them, we need to connect them, and we need to be part of that to be sure that they succeed. So I'm an optimist. I've said many times it's too late, frankly, to be a pessimist. But I sincerely am an optimist because I think at the end of the day, we will find the solutions. But obviously, it was Benjamin Franklin. I was telling Kim in the car, what shall I use to end this speech? But it was Benjamin Franklin. He's actually the originator of the U.S. Post Office. In fact, when I was young, I always thought he was a U.S. president. This has never been one. But it was Benjamin Franklin who said, you may delay, but time will not, and lost time will never be found again. And we're in that moment now of that history. If we delay too much, we have too much lost time that will cost us dearly. So I think we need to put ourselves once more as true leaders to the benefit of others to solve the situation that we find ourselves in. This is going to be a crucial year. And it was Gandhi, actually, who said that the best way to find yourself is actually to lose yourself in the service of others. No better time, just like Claude has done with Constellation, to lose yourself in the service of others and to create a better world for all. Thank you very much. S'il y a la question, on peut le faire en français, en anglais, en hollandais, en espagnol. Irlandais. Scottish. Are there any questions or comments?
I'd like to know if ENG is on the same line as you.
It's a very good company. No, I think they certainly, I wouldn't answer P&G specifically or Nestle's or the other ones, because we need a lot more companies. You cannot do it alone, and many of these companies certainly play a key part in moving forward. For example, on deforestation and making commitments to sell only sustainable palm oil or soy or paper, beef or pulp, you get a lot of companies to sign up. I found out that when you call it illegal deforestation, which we started calling it, a lot more people sign up because you feel uncomfortable to do something illegal. If we would have called this illegal climate change, we would have solved it already. So they all sign up. They all sign up. But a lot of them are very occupied with themselves and are not willing to spend sufficient time to actually enroll others to create these changes for impact. That's really what I'm talking about. Because it's easy to sign up. Often these commitments are for the year 2020, or it keeps Greenpeace out of your building. But what I'm talking about really is to have that leadership to be part of driving that change against the odds. And there we frankly need more companies. We frankly need more companies. The unfortunate thing of US companies is you have a legalistic environment. They're probably less worldly in a lot of their views as we are, perhaps less risk-taking in that sense. So it's difficult to get them on board at that same magnitude as what I'm talking about. But in its essence, they are all good companies, not business. They try to be. Like we all do. By the way, nobody is perfect. There was only one who was perfect and got crucified, and that's not something I like. Okay.
I have the mic, Nathalie Malich. As we discussed before, you have more and more CEOs who sign charters, principles, whatever. We saw it last week in New York. In your opinion, what is the best way to move from the signature to the actions? Is it control? Is it motivation? Different sets of levers? How do you see that?
I think the best way in anything is, at the end of the day, you need to rebuild trust. Trust with the world citizens, trust with society. And the only way, because that trust is this absolute fundamental of prosperity. You cannot have long-term prosperity if you don't have trust. But in order to get that trust or create that trust, you have to create transparency. So the best thing to do is transparency. And actually the tools are there now. So the more people see, for example, we have now cameras on our farms. We have family farms, we call them landmark farms for agriculture. You can now talk to the farmers, you can find out where canola comes from. In all of our factories, you can see what our social standards are. We are putting cameras now in our tea plantations. We do this because we think it's important that people see the origin of our product, but it's really trust. We want to say, you are as much part of our relationships and you ought to know all these things going on. Making data transparent. So a lot of people say things but might not necessarily do, or other things get in the way. That's true for governments, that's true for NGOs, that's true for businesses as well. So I believe very strongly in transparency. So there are many things that are happening. For example, you have to report how many women work in your company. That's a transparency. You have to report or make known what is your carbon emission in your value chain. That's transparency. And usually that leads to action. But there are a few things you want. You want CEOs, first of all, that make commitments. Because if you don't make a commitment, if you're not engaged, see, we haven't talked too much about leadership, but great leadership has four different areas, which is awareness. Because if you're not aware of the realities of this world, and you just live in your own little thing, forget it. But many people, fortunately, are aware. Then you need engagement. You need awareness and engagement. And then you need some humanity and humility, because you need to work for others. But with that comes the firm belief that you need to work in partnership, and to have that partnership you need to trust, and to have that trust you need to be willing to work in transparency. So I'm a very big proponent of having people publish more. And as you do that, you get a race to the top. You don't need policies, you don't need more government. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying get more transparency. And the best way is to get a race to the top, not a race to the bottom, like we currently see. And it's starting to happen in some areas. I think on carbon, we start seeing that. In fact, the business community now, and I honestly believe that, with some exceptions, because there are always heavy carbon-based industries who fight this change. Now, if you're a country like Saudi, you will fight this change, because it's not in your interest. In any transformation of society, there are winners and losers. I understand that very well. But you find now that the business community, for example, on carbon, is running ahead of the government. It's running ahead of the government. So if we can aggregate those forces. So what business needs to do, to come back to your question, CEOs need to commit themselves first. Otherwise, you don't get a seat at the table. Then you need to set clear targets in your own companies, individually. So you need to live what you say. And then you need to be a big advocate. So you need to go out there and convince others to make your voices known. The political community is very sensitive towards business, because at the end of the day, business is 60% of the GDP, 80% of the financial flow, 90% of the job creation now in the world. So they want businesses to be happy, and we need to speak up more. Often the voice of this loud minority dominates the silent majority. So CEOs need to speak up. So if they make commitments, if they do their own plans, if they speak up, and then the fourth thing would be to work in partnerships to lead to these bigger transformations. Just like you're doing in the UN or with UN Women, you need these bigger transformations. So those are the steps I would say every company has to go through. And where you see leadership from the CEO level, you see results, like on anything else.
Good evening, I'm Jean-Daniel Pic, an alumnus from Unilever. I'd like to know why you are so optimistic about the fact that the political leaders will make the right decision in a world where they themselves are elected with short-term objectives, and there's an increasing anger rising in democracies, anger and extremism. So what makes you so optimistic?
You know, because they are also human beings, you know. They don't get elected on politicians to make the system run worse. These, most of the politicians that get elected, is they get elected at pitiful salaries, in my opinion, just like teachers and some others in the world. They get elected because they have ideals. My sister-in-law is in Dutch politics. He goes in there because he has ideals. And any politician I meet, just as any CEO, I've never met a CEO who wants more unemployment, who wants more poverty, who wants more climate change. I haven't met them yet. If there are, send them my way, because I'd love to see the spaces. So the same as politicians. They basically are good people. But the world has become so interdependent, so global, that the democratic process that has been designed is so difficult for them right now. The institutions aren't there anymore to support them. The mechanisms aren't there anymore. The fact that the internet is there now and has given us all voices, made them jump from left to right, because everybody now has an opinion. And society itself wants quick fixes. So if we now as CEOs or others, wherever we are, whatever positions we are, we need to think about our role now as more as de-risking the political process. In the past, business was waiting for governments to pass rules, laws, or regulations, and they would stick to that. They would stay within the law or do whatever. Now I think you go into the next 10, 15 years, as far as I can see, where business people, courageous business people, need to help de-risk the political process. It's only when we created this Tropical Forest Alliance, when we got enough of businesses, NGOs obviously by definition, to get together, when we went to Rio and made these declarations, that we got other governments to join. Obviously we targeted those governments, but we got the government of the US, the UK, the Netherlands. I was with Mrs. Sirleaf, who's the president of Liberia, so she joined, Colombia, Norway, and then we created this tipping point. But politicians don't join unless they are sort of sure that there's enough critical mass of businesses who want that. So that's fine. You cannot blame politicians, you need to help politicians and bring them together then. So yeah, that is our role. I was in Indonesia with Kim the other day, 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago, time goes fast, in Indonesia and in Philippines. And obviously, we are very big there. We're about 2% of the Indonesian economy, actually. So I was talking to the president, who was newly elected, and he's never been really, Widodo is his name, he's never been really in politics. So he doesn't have an apparatus around him. He fights for the poor people. I think he's a great guy. But on the global issues, he didn't understand anything yet. So the laws and rules and regulations around climate change or protecting the forests, why it's important to have sustainable palm oil, yeah, you do need to spend an hour explaining that and have a good discussion about that. And we do the same in the Philippines or in India when I was with Modi 2 weeks ago. We talk about the importance of doing these things for the investment climate. You might use different language for attracting foreign direct investment or for your employees being healthy, being able to go to work. You have to explain why it's important in the global calendar and try to bring some courage. And I hope between now, I was talking to Laurent Fabius today, we had some discussions on the road to Paris, but I hope that there will be enough courageous politicians as well in some of these countries that will pull the others along and make these commitments. And we have had a great start. We have China who made this commitment that they will peak by 2030, as you know. We have Europe putting in already the 40% reduction. We have the US coming in by 2025, the 28% reduction. We have businesses now that are saying we can do even more and we are committed to do more. We have technology that is coming up. And we frankly, don't have a choice. And I think more people are starting to realize that. But the biggest advocate, as Al Gore said in the article in the International Herald Tribune, I still call it that way, but Al Gore said yesterday in that article, you might have read it, but he said the biggest advocate to fight climate change is Mother Nature. And I think a lot of people are starting to discover that. So I'm optimistic. En plus, si on peut dire, we are survival animals. We don't like to extinct ourselves.
Thank you. Mr. Polman, at some point you said we defined the MDGs, but at that point, when the MDGs were defined, the private sector was not really at the table.
The original ones.
And at the SDGs, you are the private sector representative. So could you imagine in the future to have a UN Secretary General coming from the private sector?
I don't know if a lot of business people would have that patience nor the skills to have that. certainly won't be me if that's what you're asking. But I think what I can see, and I see that already happening, when the original Millennium Development Goals were written in 2000 with Kofi Annan at that time being Secretary General, and you are totally right, business goal partnership, which was the eighth goal, was sort of an afterthought because everybody felt bad that it wasn't in there. Now we have written goals, and actually we are at 17 goals. 169 targets, as you probably know, but partnership is all over now, and partnership is really ingrained in everything. But it's also because the world has changed, and people are starting to realize that. So whilst I cannot immediately see a business person becoming Secretary General because the process isn't there, I can certainly see a woman becoming the next Secretary General. And interestingly, women have skill sets that are actually, women, scientifically proven, are a little bit more long-term than men. They take a little bit more long-term vision. They care about their families, they invest in it. You see it in Africa, everywhere. Women also are better working in partnership. Men are growing up in a win-lose environment. Sports, language, everything. And women actually have a slightly deeper sense of purpose. So the skill sets that you need for the future leaders are actually more in women than in men. So I frankly believe there's a book that came out in the US which I don't subscribe to, which is called The End of the Era of Men. I think that's a little bit severe for all of us guys. But it certainly is, it's the time for women. And interestingly, I looked at that the other day, all the major humanitarian efforts that are going on in this world, the things that really count, you as women with Pomceli, before that was Michelin Bachelet, you have Erthrin Kasem doing the World Food Program, you have Cristiana Figueres doing the climate change negotiations, an amazing woman. You have Mary Robinson, the climate ambassador. You have Helen Clark from the UNDP. All the major humanitarian efforts in this world, I would say 7 out of 10, are actually driven already today by women. So yes, we do need women. And then what you see in the UN is more and more businesses that are actually supporting. The UN Global Compact has 12,000 members, some more serious than others, that is what you normally would expect. But businesses are showing up. When we had the climate summit in September in New York, we had 175 CEOs there. I've never seen 175 CEOs. In fact, there were more CEOs there than heads of government. And it sent a strong signal to a lot of these heads of government It's time, buddy, that you get involved, because they're still buddies, but it's time that you get involved. So I think the dynamics are changing, and, you know, but I'd rather have a woman there first for all the reasons that we mentioned than to have a CEO there. I mean, that's probably a better trade-off if we have to make choices. Okay, thanks for your time. Once more, I think it's a big round of applause for Claude, because he has worked on this day and night. He's brought us all together. It's actually been fabulous to see so many familiar faces and friends. Think about the power that's in this room. Not only could we create together the biggest new consumer goods company in the world if we wanted to. In fact, I was thinking that while I was talking, wouldn't that be a great challenge, you know, to have even a better company than Unilever. But I think we are a great group of people, because we're here to support Claude, who has worked day and night to make this possible. We all know it's for the people that couldn't be here tonight, people like Christian, his son, and many others. So thanks for what you're doing. You're people with big hearts. And as long as we continue to help each other, I certainly have confidence.